Braincast, der Schulfunk zum Gehirn.
So, welcome Dan, it's a pleasure to meet you in person after having lots of fun with your books.
Thank you very much, nice to be here.
Your second book, The Upside of Irrationality, is being published these days in Germany. It's called Fühlen nützt nichts, hilft aber. It's a lot of fun to read and it's full of insights, but it's serious science what you're doing there. It's called behavioral economics. So to get an impression on that and on your point of view, what does the behavior of rats and bankers have in common? or not to be racist, and surgeons.
Yeah, so first of all, let me just say a word about behavioral economics. Yeah. You know, so behavioral economics is really kind of a combination of lots of social science that is empirically in nature. And it's kind of attacking economics for two reasons. One, because economics has become so big part of our lives in terms of decision making, businesses and policy, that it's good to realize where economic fails and where reality starts. But the second thing that is more important is that it's a study that kind of shows us how our intuitions fail. And I think we often have this great gut feeling about what's the right thing to do. And it turns out our gut feelings are just gut feelings. They're often not correct. And it's really good to keep in mind how often it is that we're failing and to think about how we test our intuitions more generally. And the question about bankers is one example for this. So, you know, in this country, like in the US, bankers are getting paid lots of money. They're getting paid much of it in bonuses. And at the end of the day, it's the shareholders of the company who are paying their salaries. So it's not as if it's their own money, you know, which they can pay themselves as much as they want. It's shareholders' money. And the question is this an efficient way to pay people? And there's lots of reasons to give people bonuses, but one of them is to the idea that if you make people really want to achieve something, they'll be successful. And the question is this the case? And it turns out it's partially the case. It turns out that as long as we deal with simple mechanical things, more money means better performance. Mm-hmm. So imagine I asked you to jump, and I gave you a jumping bonus of either 1 euro per jump or 1,000 euro per jump. You will jump more as the bonus gets higher. And people predict that, and that's indeed the case. But what happens when the tasks require thought and memory and creativity and concentration, all of those highly cognitive skills? It turns out that here too, people think that more bonuses will yield higher performance, but here the results are actually opposite. And that's the case when we actually behave much like rats. And the idea is that incentives or money is a two-edged sword. It makes us want to perform very well, but it also stresses us. And sometimes the stress can overwhelm performance. So for example, if I told you that if you'll be funny in the next 10 minutes, really, really funny, I'll give you 10,000 euros, how much of your next 10 minutes would you be able to think about all the jokes you know, and what's the funniest of them, compared to how much stressed you would be? And it turns out that very easily stress overwhelms it. Another way to think about it is, imagine your job, and imagine there was like 100% motivation. And even without bonus, you have a high motivation, right? You can think to yourself, how much are you on this from 100%? And now, the end of the motivation, what's missing, you could say you could make up with a bonus. Could get you to do percent, but if the bonus overshoots and become too big, now you'll start thinking about it all the time. You'll be wondering, am I making my bonus? Is this good enough? Is this, and as a consequence, you're not going to perform as well. And you know, in the last kind of a couple of years, I've been going to lots of bankers and talking to them about this.
And they did listen to you?
They listen, but they don't agree with me, right? Because, you know, they get paid so much money not to agree. But so bankers say, we know we never get stress. You have no money in the world that would stress us. And it's hard to say. I mean, I'm inviting them to come to the lab and being tested. They never show up. But But they all agree to the following. They all say that for the last 3 or 4 months of the year, every day they go to their desk, they open an Excel spreadsheet, and they calculate how much bonus they will make this year. So if nothing else, even if not stressed, they agree that they spend lots of time on it. Because imagine that you could get paid lots and lots of money, and 80% of it was unknown, 80% of it was in a bonus. Wouldn't you be occupied a big part of the day, every day, with this thought about, you know, will you make this big pot of money or not? It's kind of interesting, right, that we want people to go to a particular goal, and we give them lots of money. We say, naturally, you're not going to do it, so we'll give you lots of money. But what the money does is to make you think about the money and not necessarily the end goal. So it's a really strange idea about incentive, if you think about it.
Don't they get used to that high numbers? And this is their reasoning, is it?
Yeah, so, you know, first of all, it's not clear that they get used to it, you know. Now, people get used to stuff at the end of the day. But how much time will you need to get used to stuff? It's not clear that a yearly bonus for 10 or 20 years is a lot of repeated experience, because the fact is they still seem to be consumed by it every year. And in some way, I think societies make it worse, because we tell bankers that the only thing we value about them is how much money they get. And we make lists in the newspaper that says how much money they get, and they compare it with their friends. So they become obsessed about it beyond the financial aspect. So even people who might be sufficiently wealthy and don't have to worry about it still worry about it, because we as a society have put so much value on this as a measure of their self-worth. Mm-hmm. Right? So it's, you can think of it as actually a big part of this book is the idea that if we wrote an equation of what predicts motivation, like you have a Y variable that's what predicts motivation, then you have lots of X variables, and one of them would be salary and bonus and meaning and all kinds of other variables. The question is, what are all these variables that are in this equation? And I think for bankers, one of the things we've done is we've taken lots of those other variables and replaced them with money. Okay. So, you know, you can think about, where do you find meaning at work? What do you find satisfying? Right? It could be maybe about creating an interesting website or coming up with something clever, or having your name associated with something that people... There's lots of other things that you value. For bankers, we've replaced all of those with money. So in some sense, we are making it worse.
Okay, and where do the rats come in?
Okay, so this is one of the earliest experiments in psychology, over 100 years old, in which they took a couple of rats, and they measure what is the relationship between the amount of electrical shock that they get, which is an incentive. Actually, the incentive is to avoid electrical shock.
Okay.
And how fast the rats were learning. So imagine you're a rat, you're in a maze, and some areas of the maze are safe and some are dangerous. And every day you need to figure out which one are safe and which one are dangerous. And there are different hints in the environment. One day the safe could be white and dangerous can be black. One day it could be a different color, stripes, all kinds of things like it. And you have to figure it out. And now the question is, how will your speed of learning be a function of the electrical shock? Mm-hmm. Now, when the electrical shock is very mild, you don't care. Learning is very slow. As the electrical shock gets bigger, you want to learn faster, and you learn faster and faster and faster. But at some point, the shock becomes so strong that it actually reverses. Mm-hmm. And you can think about it. Imagine you were walking in Berlin. Imagine you didn't know the city. And imagine that some areas were safe and some were dangerous, and you were getting electrical shock, depending on it. You can imagine that at some point, the electrical shock will be so powerful, it will just take your breath away. Mm. That from time to time, you'd make a wrong turn, and you just kind of get this amazing shock. And under those conditions and this level of fear, would you be able to focus, or would be totally consumed? Mm. With the shock. And the same thing happens to bankers when they become totally consumed with the financial reward. They just think about that. They don't think about their own performance actually as much.
I see. You already talk about standard economics. This is something you get Nobel Prizes for. Standard economics is very straight ahead, telling us how explaining us the behavior of markets and the behavior of market players. we are rational beings, we are rational creatures, and we always decide in our most interest. Yes. And this is completely compatible with Darwin's evolution. So,
not necessarily. There are some interesting differences between Darwinism, because first of all, the theory of evolution has no assumptions about what people try to optimize.
The survival?
Yeah, the survival, but it doesn't have to be, it's about the gene, it's not about selfish maximization, which is a different story. And also in Darwin there is elements of caring about others, mm-hmm. which is not so present in standard economics.
Yeah.
Now in evolutionary theory, your caring about others is proportional to the market structure and to how much of your genes they are sharing. Whereas in standard economics, there isn't anything like that. But there are definitely similarities.
Okay, the question was, behavioral economics is not that straight. It's kind of fuzzy.
Yes.
And there's way too much fun in it to be a serious science. So what do your classical colleagues think about behavioral economics?
Yeah, so first of all, let me tell you what I think about them. Look, the reality is that I like standard economics. I think it's a beautiful, elegant, interesting theories with some prediction power. Right? So if you look at economics, you wouldn't say it's 100% wrong, right? It's X percent right. How much is the X percent? Is it 20%, 30%? I mean, you can decide for yourself how much you think it's right. And I think the cardinal sin of economics is not that economics is wrong, but that economists have pretended it's more right than it really is.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So think about what the message is from economics when you read the introduction to economics. It says, here's a theory, it explains human behavior, it explains perfectly human behavior, and you don't need anything else. And you can take this theory and you can build public policy and you can build companies and you can build regulation, you can build markets based on that. And that, I think, is the problem.
Mm.
And when you talk to people who have PhDs in economics and have studied for a long time and are not in the University of Chicago, they all realize that economics is much more restrictive than that. It doesn't explain 100% of the variance, it explains some of the variance. But the problem is that it's so tempting to say, here's a theory that explains some things, let's not assume it explains more. That, I think, is the big problem. Now, what do economists think about behavioral economics? So I think that, first of all, they're uncomfortable with the type of messiness of behavioral theory.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I mean, if you think about it, one of the main criticisms is that there's not a single theory of behavioral economics. Behavioral economics right now, it's a set of things we don't do well. And they're not all connected into one,
mm-hmm.
one big theory. And economists kind of are upset with that because there's not a single theory. It's hard to figure out where things are. And in some sense, I think they're right. It's a shame we don't have a single theory. But I don't think we ever will have a single theory. So you're becoming an expert in vision. You know, there's lots of theories of vision. There's actually lots of mechanisms of vision.
Yeah.
We do different vision in the middle, in the retina. We do different vision in the fovea. We do different vision for night, different vision for movement. I mean, we have different mechanisms for color. Even for something as simple, you know, relatively speaking, as vision, we have many, many mechanisms. We don't have a single theory that explains all of vision. We have different mechanisms that explains different parts of vision. So now you can ask yourself, could we have a single mechanism would explain all of human economic behavior? Very unlikely, right? We're not evolutionarily designed to do economics or to do this. And we basically co-opt different mechanisms we have for dealing with this complexity of financial incentives and markets and dealing with others and so on. So I don't think we'll ever have a single simple theory. It would be nice if we would, but I don't think we would. Now, where do these two will come together? Here's my hope. I think that economics should stay economics, right? I think that the last two chapters of every introductional textbook should include some behavioral economics, but economists should keep on doing what economists are doing.
Mm-hmm.
They're contributing, it's providing interesting theory and insight and analysis. They should keep on doing what they're doing. Where things should change, I think, have to do with when we come to implement something in the real world. So if you're going to, as a company or as an individual or as a government, you're going to implement something, now I want you to be more careful. Because theory could be fun theory for its own sake, and it's an interesting intellectual pursuit. But when it comes to implementing something in the world, now I want you to be more cautious. I want to say how much of it should be explained by economics, and how much of it should be explained by psychology and sociology and philosophy. And maybe instead of implementing something based on our gut intuition, we do an experiment that tests which one of these two forces are more relevant in this particular case. So, for example, imagine that we're going to try and create a new educational policy, yeah. Right? And we want to incentivize the teachers and the principal and the students. How should we incentivize them? Economics has a very simple answer for this. Pay them. Psychology has a more complex answer for this, which says that sometimes you can pay people and results can actually backfire. Sociology will probably have a different answer. And before you go and implement something that would cost, you know, millions of euros, maybe it's good to kind of stop and think and saying, here's some inputs from psychology, from sociology, from economics. Let's do a couple of studies and trying to figure out which one of those seems to be the best, mm-hmm. the best combination.
This would be rational.
it wouldn't be rational in the formal sense, because remember that in principle, we're supposed to know all these answers, right? This is basically saying we don't know. We're just going to admit how much we don't know, and we're going to try it out.
There's one typical thing about behavioral economics that makes it, for me as a consumer, very much fun. It's often counterintuitive. So what I learned in your book is that commercial ads in the TV make my life happier? Really?
Yeah, you know, it's very surprising, but it does. You know, by the way, I think that this is the most interesting thing, is how often our intuitions are wrong. Mm-hmm. It's really quite amazing when you think about it. And maybe the biggest irrationality of them all is the fact that we don't seem to recognize how irrational we really are and how much our behavior is not driven by what we think is driving it. So think about this issue of adaptation. Imagine you have a fun experience, something fun like a massage. And I'm asking you, would it be better if you took breaks in the middle? And people mostly say, no, it's so much fun, why would I take breaks? Now let's think about something not fun. You're doing your taxes. Is it good to take breaks in the middle? And people say, yes, of course I want to take breaks. And it turns out that the breaks are consistent with what people believe. So if you have something fun and you take a break, the break is unpleasant. Mm-hmm. If you make something that is not fun and you take a break, the break is pleasant. But what people fail to understand is that when they go back to the experience will be different than the one they have left. So here's what happened. You start a massage, and the massage is fun. And over time, the massage becomes less and less and less fun. Mm-hmm. You start something unpleasant like doing your taxes, and over time, it becomes slightly less annoying. You get used to it. This is what adaptation is about. Now, this is the natural progression if you keep on being there. But what happens if you stop and take a break? If you have a massage and it's becoming worse, not as good, and then you take a break, when you get back to it, it's not where you left it, it's a little bit better. Mm-hmm. And then you go down a little bit, then you take a break and you come back, it's a little bit better. And the same thing with negative events. Something starts negative, becomes better, you take a break, get back to it, it's really miserable. Right? So what happened is that we have this incredible ability to adapt, which is both good and bad. It's good that we get used to bad stuff. It's not as good that we get used to good stuff. But what happened is that when we take breaks, those breaks reduce adaptation. They slow down the adaptation process. Mm-hmm. So when we have something good, we want to slow down adaptation. When we have something bad, we don't want to slow down adaptation. So the advice is, when something good is happening, take breaks, which is very counterintuitive. You watch a movie, take a break. You're having a wonderful meal, take a break. You can think for yourself whether if you have sex with your significant other, whether it's worthwhile to take a break in the middle or not. But on the other hand, if you do something that is not good, that you're not really enjoying, it's best to just focus and finish it and not take these breaks. That's not tempting.
Counterintuitive. Another thing I stumbled over and was very fascinated with, what is it about self-hurting?
Yeah. Here is the basic idea. Imagine that there are two ways for us to make a decision. We can consult our preferences, saying what do I like, what do I don't like, or we can rely on our memory and say what did I do before. It turns out in many cases relying on what we've done before is an easier path, because what we've done before is very salient for us, while computing our preferences is hard. So think about something like a glass of water. How much is this worth for you? How much would you pay for it? Very hard to figure out. Mm-hmm. Is it worth, you know, €1, €1.50, €0.50? Really hard to figure out.
How thirsty am I?
That's right. And how much is this a pleasure that it will give to you? But what you can do is you can rely on your memory and say, last time I paid X for it, more or less. Now, because of this, what we often do is we often rely on our memory rather than our preferences. Mm-hmm. So here is the idea. Imagine that you go to a new country and they have a new currency and you don't know much about what's going on, and there's a new fruit you've never tasted before. And you end up paying whatever, 1,000 currency unit for that particular fruit. The next time you come to think about that fruit, what do you know? Do you know how much pleasure you derive from it? Do you know what's your opportunity cost? What else you're giving up? Very hard to think about. But you say, I remember what I paid last time. I remember last time I paid 1,000 units, whatever it is. And you say, I always make the right decision. Last time was no exception. I must have made the right decision. Let me repeat that. And that basically creates a situation in which you can behave once in a certain way. And because you remember your behavior, you can keep on behaving in the same way over and over and over, even though the initial decision was not necessarily ideal for you.
Okay, I bought an expensive car, so I buy another one.
Yes. Now, with expensive cars, there's multiple things that happen. You buy an expensive car, you get used to driving expensive cars. But beyond that, you don't go back and say, let me look at the whole range of cars and think about how should I spend my money. You say, I bought an expensive car last time, must have made sense. I'm in similar situation to what I was before. Let me keep on doing the same decision.
And this is all subconscious, unconscious.
So, yeah, so, you know, subconscious, unconscious, these are tough distinctions to make, because the kind of conditions under which we call something, it could be... Is it aware? Is it unaware? Is it deliberative? I mean, there's lots of different terms. What I'm comfortable saying is that it's not a highly deliberative process. Mm-hmm. So it's not that you necessarily tell to yourself, I did this before, let me do this again. There is something habitual about it.
Okay. What I do not quite understand is the line between behavioral economics and social psychology. When I look in social psychology, there are even some experiments like the ones of Philip Zimbardo with the locus, to whom they taste better. They could be from you. Where is the line between social psychology and behavioral economics?
So I don't think there's a line in the science. Mm-hmm. I think there's a line in the rhetorics and the models. And, you know, I think I do a little bit of both. I publish some papers in psychology. I try to publish some things in economics. Behavioral economics, I think... So papers are really in behavioral economics when they go directly against an economic theory. Mm-hmm. So you can have a theory of incentives and you go directly in it. You have a theory that people have complete preferences or people have transitive preferences and you go directly... and that. So I think those are clear. And there's also some things that are clear about social psychology that have nothing to do with utility, for example. But in the middle, you're right, there's lots of things that could be phrased in either direction. And the question is just, how serious are the people taking economics as a starting point? And what is the audience that this is written to? I think that, you know, if economics was not so successful, we wouldn't have behavioral economics.
Okay.
Right? So I think the reason you have behavioral economics is because economics has been the most successful social science. Mm-hmm. From a practical perspective, people are just using it all the time. Look around and think about what is policy and what is the legal system based on. Mm-hmm. It's all based on simple ideas from economic theory. Now, the reason for me that behavioral economics is important is that I want these decisions in policy and business and government and law to be based on more reasonable understanding of human behavior and not just on the assumptions. So really, behavioral economics for me is a reaction to the success of economics, okay, and not a reaction to the actual existence of economics. If economics would have stayed an academic field, I don't think there would have been behavioral economics as would have become so important. In the same way that we're not saying let's incorporate psychology into sociology. I mean, sociologists are perfectly fine to describe the things at the level that they are describing. But it's really the success of economics and the overarching claims of economics that worry people like me when we come to design markets, for example. Mm-hmm. So think about the financial market. Think about healthcare. I mean, all of those things, right? It's really kind of disturbing that they are created with such simple assumption of economic theory.
This must be especially bad when you're living in America.
Well, I think maybe England is even worse, but yeah, it's very bad in the US, there's no question. And also, in the US, there is this ideology of Milton Friedman, which is kind of amazing, because you talk to people who never took a class in economics, and they talk as if they were disciples of Milton Friedman. I mean, mm-hmm. people talk about, you know, the individual is doing better than the government, and it's always the case that in taxes, and I mean, all of those things, people have this ideology that is kind of really deep down and quite well ingrained about the superiority of the individual over the government, and the, mm-hmm. and of course now there's a huge tax debate in the US, and this is actually very, very disturbing.
It's not much better in Germany, I have to admit. Another line I don't really understand is, where is it between behavioral economics and neuroeconomics? And you look in the minds of people, but there are no brains in behavioral economics, or no huge expensive hardware.
Yeah.
Isn't it tricky? You just have clever ideas about clever questions to ask?
Neuroeconomics is basically, I think, limited to using expensive neuroimaging technique to look at the same questions. And, you know, so far it's been a really interesting field, but its contribution to our understanding of economics or psychology has been a little more limited than you would hope, like compared to how much money we're spending on it. But, you know, it's early days, and it's good to start doing it just to see how things are moving. Mm-hmm. But it's basically just describing things on another level of analysis, right? So, you know, psychology often is about, you know, people's general behavior. Behavioral economics care more about what people do when the incentives are set up in certain ways. Like, they rely less on what people say they will do and more about what they were doing. Neuroeconomics tries to look at the brain mechanism that underlie those behaviors. Now, it will never substitute behavior, because economics and behavioral economics are based on what people actually actually do, but it tries to create a layer of explaining some of those behaviors. And the question is, what level are you comfortable with an explanation? And I think that there probably will be a day when neuroeconomics will be a really important contributor to the field. But right now, it's very hard to think about questions we had about how people make decisions that were answered by neuroeconomics. Mm-hmm. It gives some support to some things, but it hasn't really kind of solved big problems. It provided new insights, but hasn't really created lots of breakthrough. Not yet. Hopefully one day. Neuroscience is very coarse these days. If you think about something like fMRI, mm-hmm. it's like 1 square millimeter of brain. It's a lot of space, 1 square millimeter, right? So we need to wait until the technology gets much, much better, probably.
You have neurons in doves that decide that stop ticking when the firing rate slows down under the firing rate of another neuron, and the dove decides not to wait any longer and take a smaller incentive.
Some of the interesting work has come from single cell recording, as you describe, and thinking about single cells as kind of decision makers in economics. But this I think is a field where it's not as clear how single cells aggregate to behavior, which is what economics is interested in. But this is actually something that economics has actually been useful mm-hmm. for neuroscience, where you take the theories from economics about competition and signal and so on, and you look at how the neurons behave. So there actually has been some input from economics into neuroscience that I think has been helpful.
You talk a lot about emotion in your new book. Isn't there a connection between those neuroscientists who never talked about emotion 20 years ago, before Damasio and Ledoux came, and now have a completely different view about the human nature being driven by emotion and not just by ratio? Isn't there a parallel? Did you read all those Damasios and Ledoux?
Yeah, of course. I haven't thought about, have they caused this stir for us as well? But I think it's highly possible. I mean, I didn't think about what's the evolution of our interest in emotion, but it's clearly been on the rise in the last few years. So, and I'm sure Damasio has contributed a lot to it. I'm wondering, it's hard to do the experiment in your mind about what would happen if Damasio wouldn't have published his work, and how interested would we be in emotion? What other things would have caused us to start focusing?
I didn't mean it to be causal, but it's a parallel I see.
Yeah, no, and I agree. There's definitely a revival of being interested in emotions. And it could be that part of it comes from neuroscience, because one of the things that neuroscience have done is to show us that there really are these different systems, that there is some sense in talking about emotion as being separate from cognition in some important ways. Part of it are the results in which it show that sometimes emotion help and sometimes they hurt making decisions, especially financial decision. There's also all this work that comes more from persuasion and advertising mm-hmm. that talk about the importance of emotion. So I think there's been kind of a conglomerate of forces that are pointing more and more to the importance of emotions. And that, I think, is now making its way toward economics as well.
Let's bring it all together with the evolution and advertising and economics with the market of love you write about in your book. This is a little strange for an economist to write about love. It wouldn't have been thinkable 10 years ago, would it?
Well, Becker has a theory of marriage. But in Becker's world, it's just about unit of production, right? So it's kind of an interesting contrast, right? For Becker, you can talk about marriage as, two people get together to make it more efficient to produce. All of a sudden, you don't need 2 households and 2 kitchens. You can allocate tasks. You can think about people getting together as an efficient factory in mm-hmm. some sense. That's part of the theory of what marriage is about in style economics. I've looked at a few things in love, and I do think it's an important thing. For one, I think it's a really important market. I don't know how it is here in Germany, but in the US, I would think that the singles market is one of the least efficient markets from all the possible markets, with perhaps the exception of the financial market these days. But here's what happens in the US. People go to high school. Then they move to a different state for undergrad. Then they move for a different state for the first job. Then 2 or 3 years, they move again to a different state. What's the chance they'll meet somebody that they like? Every time that they just meet somebody, it's time to go and move somewhere else. On top of that, people work long hours. So when are you going to meet somebody? It's very hard to date somebody that you work with in the same workplace. People don't look kindly on it. And some of my friends, some of my professor's friends were really kind of stuck in this situation. Imagine you're a new faculty, you're working very hard. All the people around you are either other faculty, which is not that exciting, or students, which are out of consideration. You're really stuck, right? So, so because of that, the need for new market mechanisms are really important. And again, it's kind of interesting. In every other aspect of life, we move toward markets. Financial markets become consolidated. Supermarkets become consolidated. Mm-hmm. Shopping centers. I mean, lots of things become consolidating markets. In the love market, what happened? There's no yente. Parents don't tell their kids what to do. It all become decentralized. All of a sudden, you have to do on your own what you should find. And it's kind of interesting, right? Should we let people find love on their own? Are we good at this? And are the conditions right for it? And I think they're not. So what do we have in the US and here too? Online dating.
Yeah.
Right? And online dating is supposed to be a market to get people to meet each other. And the question is this a good market? And the answer is that it's a really important market, central, could be useful, but it's a really badly designed market. Okay. And here's the experiment I want you to do as a thought experiment. Imagine I asked you to give me a list of 100 people. 50 people you really like and 50 people you don't like so much. And I said, give me the names of those people and I'll go to all of them. And I'll ask them all to describe themselves based on some online dating website to fill the profile. But without their picture and without their name. And now I come back to you with 100 profiles from an online dating site, and I say, please sort them into two piles, the people you like and the people you don't like. What do you think would happen?
I guess I wouldn't even realize who is who.
You wouldn't realize who is who, but you would not be able to predict who you like and who you don't like. Because what happened is that the way we describe people and the way in online dating sites and the way we consume people are very different. Now, online dating sites take people and try to break them into attributes like cameras. What's the F ratio and the type of lens and how many megapixels and so on. But when you meet somebody for a coffee or when you talk to them, it's not about those characteristics. I mean, some things are important. You might care if they're smokers or non-smoker and how old they are and there's some. But the experience we have with a person that tells us whether we want to spend many hours with them, doing all kinds of things with them, are not about those characteristics. People are much more like wine. When you taste wine, you know what it's like, you know if you like it or don't like it. But if I gave you a list of wines with descriptions, it would be very hard for you to say what it would look like to taste, what it would feel like to taste this wine and how much you would enjoy it.
Unless I'm a connoisseur, and then I wouldn't need a market.
It turns out that even for connoisseurs, it's very hard. Is there an expression in German, in Yiddish, there's an expression, Feinschmecker. It's a German expression?
Yeah.
So we did a study with Feinschmeckers on wine. We went to a wine store that had all these people that thought that they knew how to taste wines. And we tried, how good were they? So in one experiment, we gave them 5 wines, and they describe each of them on a piece of paper. They wrote down the description. Then we mixed it, we gave it to new people. We said, try and match it. Nobody could. Okay. We mixed it again, we gave it back to the same people who wrote the description. Even they couldn't do it. It turns out that when you drink wine, you can have a feeling of what it is, but it's really hard to describe it. Mm-hmm. And there are few people in the world who can do it, but that's it. Now, look, going back to online dating. Online dating is just a badly designed market, right? It takes people, and it describes them in a way that is easy for computers to describe people, mm-hmm. but not in an easy way that is good for people to understand what those people mm-hmm. are. And by the way, I think the lessons we've learned from that is not just about online dating. It's about lots of stuff. Think about something like insurance. You have car insurance. Your car insurance is described by the easy things for insurance company to describe the insurance. How much deductible do you have, and what's your limit, and how much uninsured motorist you have. You have no idea how much it's really reducing your risk. I mean, that's what you really care about. Mm-hmm. Or think about something like your computer. You know how much RAM it has, and what the bus size speed is, and what's the refresh rate. I mean, there's all these characteristics. But that's not what you care about. What you really care about is how responsive is the computer. And does it turn on fast, and does it switch fast, and do you have to think about the computer when you work, or do you do it naturally, and is the keyboard comfortable or not, and how long can you work without feeling tired about it? Mm. I mean, but what we do often is the industry chooses to describe things in terms that are easy for the industry and not necessarily easy for people the way that we understand and think and consume information. Now, there is a good part to all of this. And the good part is that we took a step back and we said, let's look at online dating and let's look at dating in general. And what do people do in dating? That's kind of like an evolutionary approach, right? We said, let's look at what people have done. We said, people go on dates. What do people do on dates? Do they sit in an empty room and talk to each other? No. People go and do something together. They go to a gallery. They go for a walk. They go to a restaurant. They get something else that they can then react with. So maybe if I just interviewed you and the question was, would I want to be your friend? It would be hard for me to do. But maybe if we went and did something together, I could use the interactions we have in the outside world with other things as an indirect way to learn about you. Mm-hmm. It would actually give me more information. So we tried that out. We created a virtual online dating space in which people could come together and see stuff, pictures and art and images, and they could talk about it. Mm-hmm. And the question was, is this going to be more successful than regular online dating stuff? And the answer was yes. We basically doubled the chances that people would go on a date compared to an online dating situation. So that, I think, is a really good outcome. I will tell you one other thing that was kind of very curious. So we got lots of data from online dating sites, and we looked at it. And part of it, we looked at emails that people exchanged. And you would think that this would be fascinating reading material. You would think that people would write passionate, intimate. No, it's unbelievably boring. It's like, where did you go to school and how many brothers and sisters you have? Unbelievably boring. The question was, why do people write this boring stuff? And one of the interesting concepts in economics is that the idea that there's multiple equilibria. So imagine that there's space of all kinds of ways that we could coordinate behavior. There's lots of ways to coordinate, to have equilibria, but many of them are not good. Not all of them are ideal. And sometimes we try to find the ultimate one, but there are many of them that are not necessarily perfect. And we wondered whether people gravitate to a non-optimal equilibria when they talk about online dating. So what did we do? We created a game. And in the game, if you and I were dating, we couldn't just exchange information. You, if you were asking me a question, you were limited to 20 questions. You couldn't ask anything you wanted. You were limited to 20 pre-selected questions, and all of those questions were interesting. How many relationships have you had before? Why did you break up from your last romantic relationship? any history of sexually transmitted diseases, any psychotic episodes in the family, you know, what's your fantasies? I mean, really interesting questions. And what happened? Everybody was happier. Mm-hmm. The people who asked the questions were happier. The people who answered were happier. The truth is, nobody wants to be asked about their CV, about their resume, right? So asking better questions. So here's the idea. We have lots of equilibria, and we can just think about how we can eliminate the bad ones. Now, online, it's easy. You can just restrict people's access. In real life, it's a little harder. Next time you have a party, imagine that you say, today, no discussion about sports or weather. Right? This is basically eliminating all kind of bad equilibria. It turns out that when you let people ask whatever they want, they ask boring, uninteresting, but also non-risky questions. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, nobody's happy. And the question is, how do we eliminate those bad coordination, bad coordinations, and allow people to actually be happier?
After publishing her findings, Helen Fisher got a mail from the industry. Did you get one?
No, Helen Fisher is working with chemistry and Match.com. I'm starting to work with some companies, but these days I'm actually much more interested in working with the government, right? Because my hope is to think about how we change policy. I mean, we'll see what will happen with the next elections in the U.S. But if you ask me where my passion lies, is to try and do something for policy.
I found one chapter in your book being very sad, and it was about the relativity of pain and the experience of cancer patients. Can you tell me something about that?
Yeah. So the experiment we did had to do with how do people like me who got a bad injury experience pain much later in life, many years after this is gone. And the question is, what is the experience of what's the effect of early experience with pain or later experience with pain? And what we found was that people like me actually can suffer much more pain with much less negative experiences. So we did this by asking people to put their hand in hot water and keep it for as long as they can. And we found out that people with severe injuries were able to do it to a much larger degree. And the idea became that if you think about when I had particular pain, it was usually associated with getting better. It was when my bandages were removed, the part of the treatment, physical therapy, operations, all of those things that are very painful were associated some level with getting better.
You were burned as a teenager.
I was burned. I spent about 3 years in hospital, lots of terrible treatments and lots of kind of deep changes in life because of that. So we find that severe injuries, people can sustain much more pain than people who didn't have severe injuries. But one of the things we found was that we had a few people in the sample, not enough, but we had a few people that had chronic pain. These are people that had cancer, kidney problems, things that were not as easily associated with getting better. Mm-hmm. If you're a cancer patient and you get more pain, it usually says that your things are getting worse rather than better. And we found that those people, even though they had lots and lots of experience with pain, the tolerance was actually very low. And the reason, again, is that they did not have these positive signals from pain. So the general news is that pain is a signal that has a lot to do with how we interpret it. Mm-hmm. And our experiences in life and our association can teach us to interpret it in more and less positive ways over the years. And I think that's kind of the interesting aspect about all of this. So it's not just about the pain, it's not just about the way the nerve firing works and how they register. There's a question of what you do with this signal. And sometimes you can be in a situation which you're just not that worried about that, or you don't think it's as frightening or as negative.
Okay, you talked about your personal aim in this book, and you compared us all to Homer Simpson. your hope is, if I see this correctly, that we all realize that we are much more irrational than we think we are. Seeing this from the social psychology side, are we able to get this insight, to stand there and think about ourselves and say, yes, I am irrational right now?
So I think there's a question of how much power and control we feel and how much irrational we have. So, you know, part of it is I hope that people would read some, you know, my books, some other stuff, and that will, and they will have an idea, they will see themselves in some of the chapters, right? So the ideal chapter for me is something that say, people say, hey, I see myself doing this particular behavior, and then maybe thinking about changing it.
But the reaction, sorry, the reaction is another, oh no, not that again.
No, you know, often I actually get, often people say, no, I see myself doing it, I'm going to think about it differently, doing something differently. I also hope that people would become more experimentalist. Mm-hmm. Saying, you know what, there's a possibility, here's something I do a lot, there's a lot of money at stake or time or resources, let me think about how I could do this. Then there's a question of, is this a depressing perspective on life? Right? Is behavioral economics a depressing perspective on life? And I think it's actually quite optimistic. So, you know, on one hand, it's nice to believe that people are rational and wonderful and everybody optimizes. And it's a little bit depressing to say people are myopic and vindictive and emotional and confused and don't know what they want and so on. But if you think about the world, how do you want to think about the world? Is this an outcome of lots of rational people? Or is this an outcome of lots of irrational people, but it means we can also do better. And I actually prefer the other one. I look at the world around and I said, there's lots of things I just wish we would change. And I think it's actually quite nice to think that it's not an outcome of everybody actually optimizing. And instead it could be some mistakes. And if you think about some mistakes, you can think about fixing stuff. Mm. So that's for me, it's the optimistic thing. We're here not because this is optimal, we're here because this is suboptimal and we could do much, much better.
Okay, now...
Let me say one more thing. This agency question is quite interesting, how people can do better with agency. We're actually developing an iPhone app now that asks people to take the perspective of somebody else. Mm-hmm. So imagine you're facing a decision, should you buy new shoes? And you open your phone and say, should I buy new shoes? You type the question, you say the number, the price. And then you have a few people that you admire in your address book. Your wife, your mother. And you can choose one of them. You choose your mother. And you say, what would my mother tell me to do in this situation? Would you tell me to go for it or not to go for it? So and you take her vision in your mind and you say what you think she would tell you. And by doing that, you take an outside perspective. Mm-hmm. On the decision by somebody you appreciate. And then this actually, we find that this changes people's behaviors. But on top of that, the app actually sends an email to your mother and says that you were thinking about buying these shoes, you consulted this, and you thought that she would say whatever she... You thought, and then she has a chance to correct you if that was wrong. So this is... Actually, I'm a big believer in phones. Okay. Because I think that phones are... with us when we make decisions. Mm-hmm. You know, good intentions are one thing, but the question is, how do we get decision aids at the moment that we face decisions? And the phone is a fantastic instrument for that. So I think over the years we'll make many more of those.
Sorry, I'm not quite that optimistic, because it's knowing about all these things we talked about, it's just a question about who shall I ask now who tells me that I shall buy those shoes?
Yeah. So you could just use it to justify yourself, right? That's fine. But we hope that you will not have your whole... So part of it is that you choose your brain trust in advance. Mm-hmm. One of the default is going to be the Pope. We don't think he will answer, but we think, you know, there is a sense of who do you really want to help guide your decision. Now, if at the moment you don't want this to happen, you can just not use the phone. Mm-hmm. But to the extent that you want it to happen, here you have a mechanism to try and do a bit better. And if you start using it as a habit, you might continue using it, even though in those cases that otherwise you wouldn't want to do it.
What's the name of the app?
Well, it will be called Perspective. It's not out yet. I hope in a couple of weeks.
Okay. Then last question. Did you change those light bulbs by now?
You know what? I bought some light bulbs. They're all ready. They're waiting.
Okay. Thank you very much. This was very interesting and funny. Thank you.